I want to try to be quantitative this time and make sure that you weigh the amount of stuff so you can calculate a percentage yield. Any questions? All right. In chapter two, we were talking about hybridization and things like that. We mentioned that we will see three classes of carbon compounds. Those with single bonds, that is sp3 hybridization, double bonds, sp2, and triple bonds that are sp hybridized. These three different classes of compounds are examples of what we call functional groups. Functional group for a carbon-hydrogen compound that contains only sp3 carbons is called an alkane. The general formula for an alkane is CN, where N is the number of carbons, H2N plus 2. Again, only carbon hydrogen, and all carbons are sp3. If we have one or more double bonds in there, we call this an alkene. For every double bond, we're going to lose two hydrogens in our general formula. So it's CnH2n if we have one double bond, etc. Finally, CnHn shows us we have a triple bond. Again, we're going to lose four hydrogens for every triple bond in an alkyne. Functional groups. Functional groups are important in organic chemistry, because functional groups tend to react the same regardless of what the carbon skeleton is. So we will look at reactions of alkenes. We'll see lots and lots and lots of different reactions. But regardless of what's attached to your alkene, basically all the reactions will be the same. They'll give the same types of products. This is an alcohol, an OH functional group. Virtually all alcohols will have the same group of reactions. This is an ether, oxygen in the middle here. Again, all ethers will have the same basic reaction. Now, when I talk about reactions, this is an example. We're not going to do this, but this is just an example of what we mean by a simple chemical reaction. Regardless of what the alkene is, regardless of what's attached at these points that I've just left open here, if we take an alkene and react it with bromine, usually in a solvent like carbon tetrachloride, we will form a 1,2 dibromide. Again, regardless of what's attached here, it will always give a 1,2 dibromide. All these reactions will have the same mechanism. They will involve what we'll call a bromonium ion intermediate and the stereochemistry, or the spatial orientation of our products. It's always going to be trans, that is, with the bromines adding on opposite sides of our molecule. So that's what we mean by functional group reactions. Now, what we're going to do is look at a long list of functional groups. I hope that, I see some of you don't have them. I was hoping that by now everybody would have the mini prints. Really, you need to do this.
They were not
chapter 3. For chapter 2, yeah, they're part of chapter 1.
Oh, this is chapter three.
For chapter three? They're not up yet?
That's right.
Oh my gosh. If I forget to put something up like that, please send me a quick email and say, hey, could you put those up? Okay? Because sometimes I just forget. Mini prints are really good because you can avoid taking lots of notes and simply do it right on the sheet, and it makes it really good. I apologize for not getting those up. I just forgot. But okay. Whoops. We talked about alkanes. Again, alkanes only have sp3 CH bonds. An example is this two-carbon unit. We will call this ethane. F means two carbons, and again, they're both sp3. An alkene, this will be ethene. It has a simple carbon-carbon double bond. This is ethine, an alkyne, carbon-carbon triple bond. We will see benzene rings. The functional group for a benzene ring is actually called an arene. We'll understand why it's called arene. Arene stands for aromatic, but we do that next semester. This is an example. This is benzene itself, C6H6, everything in a row. If we put a halogen on a simple alkane, we call that an alkyl halide. And again, this can be bromine, chlorine, fluorine, iodine, whatever. Alcohol, we saw earlier, simply an OH. This is methanol. Ether, oxygen's in the middle of our carbon chain. If we stick an NH2 out here, this is an amine. The amine functional group, the reactions of an amine, are basically going to be dependent upon the fact that it has an unshared pair of electrons here on the nitrogen. This is a nitrile. We're all familiar with cyanide, everybody's favorite poison. This would be cyanide if we had just a lone pair here. This is acetonitrile, it's called. Again, one carbon here, and then the carbon-nitrogen triple bond. Other ones that we'll see. This is a sulfide. Remember we had an oxygen in the middle that was an ether? Well, sulfur and oxygen do a lot of the same sorts of things. So this is a sulfide. SH instead of OH is called a thiol. The thing about thiols that's interesting is that they really, really stink. Butane thiol is the essence of skunk, etc. Sulfides aren't much better, garlic and whatever. And finally, nitro compounds here. This is simply a nitro group bonded directly to the carbon. Nitromethane, this is a very high energy compound used in racing fuels, stuff like that. Carbon oxygen double bond is referred to as a carbonyl. It's an extremely important functional group in organic chemistry. If you think about the carbon-oxygen double bond, we have a difference in electronegativity here of about one unit. The oxygen is going to draw the electrons from this double bond up to itself, making it very polar. Because it's polar, that means that this carbon is partially positive. And we'll see that things with electrons, so Lewis bases, things with electrons will react with this carbonyl at the carbon, and we'll get a huge variety of reactions. Very important concept in organic. Again, most of the reactions we'll cover next semester. We name carbonyl compounds depending on what's on either side of the carbon-oxygen double bond. If you have a hydrogen on one side, it's called an aldehyde. If you have carbons on both sides, it's a ketone. If you have an OH on one side, that's a carboxylic acid, acetic acid, acidic component of vinegar. That's what this is. And if you have an O something bonded to carbon, this is called an ester. Esters are the fruity, sweetie smells that show up in perfumes, in fruit, etc. Very nice compounds. Just a couple more. If we have an amine on one side, this is called an amide. The backbone of proteins is a polyamide. So again, in terms of biochemistry, the amide functionality is a very, very important species. Halogens, called an acid halide, very reactive because we have two things, withdrawing electrons, very reactive carbonyl, and finally an anhydride. Anhydride, we take two carboxylic acids, stick them together, split out water, that's why it's anhydride, and we get something like this. Again, this is going to be very reactive. Things will hit this carbonyl, this will leave, and we'll make new compounds. Any questions on the concepts here? Now we're going to talk about functional group reactions. The general approach that McMurry takes is something that was pioneered years ago called the functional group march, where you take each functional group one at a time, go through all the reactions, the nomenclature, stereochemistry, whatever. So we need to know all these, and we're going to learn all the reactions, how to make them, et cetera, et cetera. All right, let's drop back to our simplest functional group, and that's the alkane. This is an animation that I made of a computer simulation of a simple 5-carbon alkane. And the point of this is to simply demonstrate the dynamics of this compound. If you note, without this having translations in the X and Y, we have just lots and lots of things going on here. Lots of different microscopic conformations. That's because in an alkane, in fact, in most carbon compounds that are single bonded, we have free rotation around any single bond. So these things are spinning madly. Because of that, we can have what are called isomers, conformational isomers. In a conformational isomer, all we're doing is taking, in this case, carbon single bonds, and we're rotating around them. We're going to rotate around them very, very quickly. This compound and this compound are the same chemical compound. They just have different conformations. Now you can prove it that they're the same compound. Just look here for the longest chain of carbons. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, don't we? In the middle carbon, carbon number 3, we have a 2-carbon unit sticking up. Carbon number 3, 2-carbon thingy sticking up. They're the same compound. Now, these rotations that we saw on the previous slide happen very, very quickly. These things rearrange the conformation about 10 to the 6 times per second. Now what that means is, a million times a second, this guy changes his conformation. They are technically isomers. Isomers have the same chemical formula. In this case, they have the same connectivity. That is, 5-carbon chain, 2-carbon chain. The same connectivity. But they're different. Conformational isomers, however, because they change so rapidly at room temperature, we don't regard these as real isomers. And we'll see some exceptions to this as we go through the course. But conformational isomers like this guy and this guy are essentially considered the same compound. Any questions? Just a slightly different perspective on it. Here I took a model of 5-carbon alkane with a CH3 sticking out in the middle, and we have this as our 5-carbon chain. This is our five carbon chain, simply differing in orientation here. And this is our five carbon chain. These are all considered the same compound. Any questions? All right, that's conformational isomers. A more interesting type of isomer is called a constitutional isomer. In a constitutional isomer, we have different chemical compounds. However, they have the same molecular formula. This is C7H16. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's an alkane, so 2N plus 2 is 16. This is also C7H16. And yet these two are totally different chemical compounds. You can tell they're different simply by looking at their connectivity once again. Here we have a two carbon chain on carbon number 3. Here we have a one carbon chain on carbon number 3. Any question on the concept? Well, this allows us to do a fairly fun and interesting game here. I've highlighted the two chains. If I tell you to draw all the isomeric compounds you can that have the formula C3H8, try to do it. C3H8. You do your general formula here. This is, if that's N, this is 2N plus 2, so it's an alkane, isn't it? Question is, how many alkanes can you draw with three carbons? One. Now that's simple. So this one would never be on the exam, for sure. There's only one way you can take three carbons, hook them together. This is a simple alkane looking like that. All right, let's make it more interesting. C3H6. We've lost two hydrogens here. Remember, that means we have a double bond. Well, there's one other option we'll talk about in a second. So we want to make a three-carbon alkene. Now there's really only one way you can do that. Three carbons in a row, a double bond between carbons 1 and 2. Doesn't matter if you draw it this way or flipped it over or upside down, whatever, same compound. We can also get C3H6, however, if we have a cycloalkane. That is, if we take our three carbons, put them in a ring. Here's a little triangle. Three carbons, six hydrogens. C4H8. C4, so N is 4, 2N is 8, so we are dealing with an alkene of some sort, right? But we have four carbons to work with. Take a minute and try drawing some isomeric compounds. Turns out there are a bunch that you can draw here. Remember, we can draw rings as well as straight chain compounds. We could draw this set of three different alkenes. Here we have a three carbon chain with a one carbon. There's a four carbon main chain. There's another four carbon chain. We could also make a cycloalkane out of it. That is, take our four carbons and put them in a ring, make a square. You think about it, is there four carbons? Each one has two hydrogens, a C4H8. Same thing with this guy. Here we have a CH3 on the end, here's another hydrogen, two more hydrogens on each one. Make this even more interesting. We can put in heteroatoms. Draw a couple C2H6Os. Remember, the oxygen must be bonded to two things. Okay? So we had two functional groups, really three functional groups with simple oxygens. That is, we had a carbonyl, we had an alcohol, that's an OH, and we had an ether, where the oxygen is stuck on both sides. The two that you can draw here that work, two carbons here, CH3, CH2, OH. This is an alcohol. This is ethanol. It's the alcohol of consumption. And this is dimethyl ether. Dimethyl ether isn't used typically. Diethyl ether is what they used to use for anesthesia. But again, the oxygen in the middle. So everyone see how to play the game? Let's just do one more. This is the one that was on the exam, of course. Now on the exam, you could have impressed me by writing lots of them. You really only needed to write five in order to get credit.
Exam, what do you mean? What do you mean exam?
I've given this course for about 37 years. I had lots of exams. Getting it right.
Well, we didn't take
any exams. No, you haven't had an exam yet.
No. So in the future.
I know it's early in the morning, but
there's going to be question like this.
All right, so we have three carbons, six hydrogens, two oxygens to deal with. Our first one is a carboxylic ester, where we have a carbonyl and an O something bonded to a carbonator. This is an aldehyde, hydrogen one side, carbon on the other. Another aldehyde where, well, this is actually an ester of formic acid. Another aldehyde, this is an ether, different ether. And the list just keeps going. Lots and lots. Now this is a very simple formula, C3H6O2. You know, one of the really fun things about organic chemistry is that if you made something, even a simple compound, C3H6O2, and you knew its molecular formula, you would still have to figure out what it was. All these are real compounds. And what we'll learn in the lab, especially next semester, is how to use spectroscopy, etc., to be able to actually distinguish between all of these types of compounds. Yeah?
On the website that you gave us, are there any like worksheets for like making these or any like practice stuff?
We will do worksheets, sample exams, all of that stuff, before our real exam.
Okay.
don't fret. All right, another game that you can play regarding isomeric structures is to show a couple compounds and simply ask the question, are these constitutional isomers? Are they identical compounds? Are they different chemical compounds and not isomeric at all? Here, your first thought is just to look at these and say, what's the formula? Okay? Here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons. It is fully saturated. That means everything is SP cubed. So this turns out to be C5H12. Over here, this is also saturated. Saturated means only single bonds. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons in our chain. These are different chemical compounds, and they are not isomeric. Yeah?
You can tell that second line is fully saturated just because there's nothing.
Yep, there are no double bonds. That's what saturated means. When you have a saturated fat, we all know what that is. Saturated fat is a fat molecule with no double bonds, only single bonds. Yeah?
Could you also say that there's not a CH3 bond to the first carbon? On the second
molecule? No, no. this is a CH3, just like this one is.
Oh, okay.
That's a CH2, so is that, et cetera, et cetera. Remember when you interpret a line structure here. Every vertex is a CH2. Every line that goes off and ends in space is a CH3. How about these two? Here you have to interpret this and compare it with this guy. Our carbon chain here, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons. Here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons. And they both have 2 chlorines. Dig a little deeper. 6 carbon main chain, chlorines in positions 2 and 4. So we'll start counting here because you want lowest numbers. Position, carbon 1, carbon 2 has its chlorine. Carbon 4 has a chlorine. Over here, carbon 2 has a chlorine. Carbon 4 has a chlorine. These are identical compounds. Remember when you read a condensed structure like this, the CHCl simply means that this chlorine is attached to this carbon.
Do you have a rule of thumb to know which side to start cutting from?
No. We want the lowest number. We're going to do nomenclature in just a minute.
Why did you start cutting from the right side of the table?
Because I could just tell. This is going to give us...
I saw this somewhere the other way, but is there... If it's a different compound, how do I know?
Oh, well, you have to look at both ends. And again, we'll do this in nomenclature in a minute. But you always shoot for the lowest number at the first point of difference. We'll see that. How about these two guys? Here we have a carbon-carbon double bond, same thing here. Our main chain is 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons. C5H10. Over here we have a main chain of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons and 2 other carbons attached. C7H14. Just remember, these guys sticking up here are CH3 groups. Not hydrogens. carbon-carbon triple bond. We have a chlorine bonded to a CH2, bonded to a triple bond and the hydrogen. We have a chlorine bonded to a CH2, our triple bond and our hydrogen. Exactly the same sequence, different representation, but the same compound. One more for practice here. This is an amide, remember? Nitrogen on one side, carbons on the other. This is also an amide. Our chain here, 1, 2, 3 carbons. 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons. We have a CH3 dangling down, a CH3 here. This is C5H11NO. Over here we have C1, 2, 3, 4, 5, C5. We have an N, an O, and 11 carbons. These are constitutional isomers with different compounds. They just have the same molecular formula. Yeah?
Sorry, I'm a little confused when I'm like looking at that second diagram and there's an N in the middle. Mm-hmm. But that means that there's a C attached to that.
No, this nitrogen is attached back to this carbonyl. It's attached down to this carbon and to a hydrogen. Nitrogen
so only
has
five
three
carbon
bonds.
Chains.
So we have one carbon,
three
carbon, two, three, four carbons, five carbons. Okay. All right, so which one was on the exam? Quickly decide, are these two compounds, well, they're not identical, we could all figure that one out. Are they isomers or not?
No.
This is a polycyclic compound. Again, one of the really neat things about organic is that you can just have such interesting little compounds. You really can. If you take and you trace around here, let's start numbering somewhere. Let's just say this was 1. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 carbons. If you now go through and sprout hydrogens everywhere, this is going to be a CH2, isn't it? That's a CH. So is that. So is that. So is that. That's what all of our hydrogens would look like. So we have C12. And if we add up all of our hydrogens, we have 14 of them. Now look at our friend on the bottom here. Whoops. Okay. I don't know why it did that, but look at our friend on the bottom here. How many carbons?
Nine.
There's more hydrogen.
Oh. Our longest chain. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Plus we have 2 1 carbon side chains. 12 carbons. How many hydrogens? We have 2 out here. 3 more here. 4, 5. Well, let's see, that's 2. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, and there's one on the end here. C12, H14. By George, these are constitutional licenses. That wasn't this fun. Yes, it's actually fun. Yes. Yes, mentally challenging. You can use your head about things like that.
But when you have, because of the double and triple bonds, you're having only one hydrogen instead of two.
Well, remember, every carbon must have four bonds. So we have a double bond here. That means there must be two hydrogens.
Yeah.
We have a double bond and a carbon, must be a hydrogen, et cetera, et cetera. That's how it works. All right, well, enough of just calling these chains and stuff like that. Let's go ahead and look at nomenclature. We're going to do nomenclature of simple and branched alkanes. Everything will be saturated, everything will be sp3 carbons. First thing we need to note is that we will identify the parent for our compound by the length of the longest continuous chain. If it has one carbon, that's a meth. Two carbons, eth, three prop, four but, five pent, six hex, hept, oct, non, dec, and then we get crazy up here. You should know up to 9 or 10. Now, these are all alkanes, so we add the suffix A and E. So one carbon, we say one using meth, and we say it's an alkane by adding A and E. Methane, ethane, propane, butane, pentane, hexane, heptane, octane, nonane, and decane. So if you have a simple straight chain, this is all you have to do to name it. You just look and you see how long the chain is. Remember, you're ordering meth, eth, prop, but, and stick ane on the end.
But if it has a double bond, then it's ene, right?
Well, double bonds are going to get more complicated. We'll do that in chapter 7, I think. But what we can do is to make our chain branched. If we have a main chain and we have things hanging off of it, we've been saying things like, here's our longest chain and we have a CH3 sticking up. Well, there's a name for that. As we saw on the previous slide, if we have one carbon, that's a meth, right? So if we have a one carbon side chain, we're going to call that a methyl group. One carbon as a side chain on somebody else's main chain is a methyl. Examples where we would use something like methyl. If we had an alcohol, we would call this methyl alcohol or methanol. This is the amine functional group. We would call it methyl amine. Now we're going to do these nomenclature as we do each functional group, but methyl is what we would use for one carbon, ethyl for two carbon, propyl for three carbon, whatever. Any questions? There's one other way that we talk about simple branched alkanes, And that is, we can refer to the individual carbons by the number of other carbons that they're attached to. If we have a set that looks like this, if a carbon is only bonded to one other carbon, R is used to indicate any generic carbon group. If it's bonded to only one, we say this is a primary carbon.
So R is just the
same as
another carbon?
Yeah, it could be any other carbon. Any other carbon.
So it wouldn't be like a halide, it couldn't
nope,
be like
nope, chlorine? Nope, nope. It has to be a carbon. But it's a carbon group of some sort. And R is what people typically use for that. If we have two things bonded to our carbon, that's a secondary, three things tertiary, or we would call it a quaternary carbon. Very simple. Just look at the carbon and ask, how many things is it bonded to? So let's show a very simple problem here. Look at this. Identify primary carbons, secondary carbons, tertiary carbons. How many primaries do we have?
Three.
This guy is bonded one, this is bonded one, that's bonded to one. We have three primary carbons. How many secondary carbons?
One.
This guy is bonded to two other carbons, and it's the only one. Tertiary carbon will be bonded to three other carbons, and there's one here in the middle. And of course, there are no quaternary carbons. All right, so we know how to identify primary, secondary, tertiary. We know how to name little side chains, and we know how to name the parent chain. Let's go ahead and put it all together with simple nomenclature of our branched alkanes. Look at these guys. This guy isn't branched at all, is it? First thing you want to do is to look at your compound and identify the longest continuous chain.
Well, if you have the chains, they're all the same length.
Well, they would all be the same length, that's all. Here, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons in a row, right? That obviously is our longest continuous chain. Because it's 6, we will call it a hex. Because it's unbranched, we will call it a hexane. Hexane. How about this next guy? What's our longest chain here? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 is bigger than 5.
Three methyl.
Very good. Where's our longest chain here?
7.
We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And we would have a methyl group and an ethyl group.
4 ethyl, 6 methyl.
Well, let's figure out how we're supposed to number these things.
2 methyl, 4 ethyl.
There's a rule for this. What you're going to do is, number one, find your longest chain. Once you do that, you're going to look and say, what are the substituents on my longest chain? Then you look at each end and you say, which end do I number from? I want to number, so I get the lowest number sequence at the first point of difference. And finally, if I have a tie for my main chain, I want to pick the main chain that has the greatest number of substituents.
This is four.
Okay, so with this guy, our longest chain here is going to look something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now I could have also started numbering up here, couldn't I?
Yeah.
Are these the same compound?
Yeah.
They're exactly the same, aren't they?
Yeah.
This one has a methyl group in carbon 2 and a 3-carbon chain here in carbon 1, 2, 3, 4. Same thing here. What if I would have said this as my longest chain? This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, isn't it? 5. This guy has 2 substituents. This only has 1. Therefore, this is not your chain. Now we want to number this guy, the one that works, so that we get our lowest number sequence. Here we have a substituent in carbon 2 and 4. If we started numbering down here, we would have our first substituent in 1, 2, 3, 4, and then in 6. 2 and 4 is better than 4 and 6. All right, once we decide our longest chain and stuff like that, all we want to do is come up with a list of substituents. We find our longest chain, we find carbon number 1, and then we're just going to list our substituents. Then we're going to take the parent and call it an alkane. So in this guy, our longest continuous chain here with the most substituents, it's just going to be this one. 8 carbons in a row. We're going to start numbering down here. So our 2 methyl groups are going to be on carbon 2. If we started numbering here, our first substituent would be on carbon 3. Now we have 2 methyl groups. The rule says we will use dimethyl to indicate there are 2 of them. And we're going to put the numbers in with a comma in between them. Commas separate our numbers, and we're going to use our prefix. So in this guy, we would have methyl groups at carbon 2, 2 of them. We would have another methyl group here at carbon number 6. So that's 3 of them. And we're going to have a 3-carbon chain, that's a propyl, down here at number 4. We have a 2,2,6 trimethyl. And we have a 4-propyl. Now we look at these and we're going to string them together alphabetically. But when we do this alphabetically, we're going to ignore our multiplier. So trimethyl alphabetizes simply as methyl. So we would write this all as one word. 2,2,6 trimethyl, dash for propyl. All one word, using dashes to separate the groups. Our parachain here was 8 carbons, so this is an octane. If we started numbering up here, we would have called this 3,3,7-trimethyl-5-propyl octane, and that would be wrong. Yeah?
So the 226 comes from having the CH3s on 2 and up to 6. You have to name each one.
Right, we have three of them. We have 1, 2, 3. So that's 226.
Okay.
Again, separated by commas. Dash trimethyl, dash 4-propyl, octane. There's no space here. It's all one word. Just dashes, commas, and octane on the end.
The trimethyl comes from which part?
Trimethyl, we have 3 methyl groups, 1, 2, 3.
Okay, I'm sorry. I just felt like we were like naming it twice.
Yeah.
It's just confusing.
It's because like 2 of them are coming off of the 2nd carbon, and then 1 of them is coming off the 6th carbon.
Right. Okay. That's exactly what it's up to. All right, finally, getting a little bit more complex, we can have a side chain that's branched. Here, our longest chain would look like this. It's a decane. We're going to start numbering here. So our first methyl group will be in carbon 2, another methyl in carbon 3, and then out here, we have this chain. That's a branch chain, isn't it? By definition, the branch chain is always connected to the parent by its carbon 1.
Yeah.
So here we have 1, 2, 3 carbons in our branch chain. On carbon number 2 of our branch chain, we have a methyl group.
So do you still name it? Do you have like parentheses and say?
Yeah, we could go this way too, it doesn't matter.
So would it be trimethyl altogether, or would it be like
well,
and then parentheses and then methyl?
Yeah, we gotta do parentheses. So we're gonna start off looking at our groups. We have methyl groups in carbon 2 and 3, so it's a 2,3 dimethyl. Right?
Yes.
In carbon number 6, we have a propyl side chain. That's 3 carbons. And on the propyl side chain in carbon number 2, we have a methyl. So we call this a 2-methyl propyl. So that's just this, attached at carbon number 6. Putting it all together, 2,3-dimethyl-6,2-methylpropyl-decane.
Are they going to be like this on the test?
No, they'll be more difficult. Naming side chains is a bother. Branch side chains, it is. Because branch side chains not only have systematic names like this, that's not what we call this. It's a systematic name or IUPAC name, IUPAC. But because organic chemistry is such an old science, and because IUPAC hasn't been around that long, all of these side chains, the common ones anyway, have their own names. So, this is the one that we just looked at. This is, well, maybe it was this one. Yeah, it was this one. 3 carbon side chain with a 1 carbon and carbon 2. This is also called isobutyl. This is isopropyl. We've all heard of isopropyl alcohol. This is secondary butyl. This is tert-butyl. Now, about the only ones that we'll really ever use would be isopropyl and tert-butyl. Aside from that, I'm not going to belabor side chains that are branched. Let's just make sure we know how they are. So if you read a name, you can figure it out and construct the compound. Yeah?
If on the exam we mean those using the systematic names, is this...
Well, you see, that's just the real issue, isn't it? If you, even if I put these on Blackboard, I have to put in so many variants on the name that these aren't good questions.
Mm-hmm. For the
sac
and the t-butyl,
are prefixes taken into consideration when naming
the compound? Yeah, I'm sorry, one more time. The sac and the t-butyl, is a T and the sac taken into consideration when naming the compound?
The isobutyl?
Yeah.
Secondary butyl.
T-butyl and the secbutyl?
Yeah. This guy and the secondary. See, this is a secondary carbon. That's why it's called secbutyl.
When you're writing the name out, mm-hmm. you know, it has
to be Oh, do you alphabetize it?
Yeah.
No. Well, no. Yeah.
Just for the second material?
Yeah.
And the iso, that's just not good.
Again, we're not going to do this a whole lot. Don't obsess about this guy. Yeah.
Can you go back to the previous slide one more time?
I'm sorry?
Can you go back to the previous slide one more time? I'm just a little confused about the...
Let's see what was on this slide.
Purple. Where that?
Six. 2-methylpropyl.
So it's coming off the sixth carbon. I get
on
that.
Sixth carbon, we have a 3-carbon chain, 1, 2, 3. That's a propyl.
Okay.
And on this propyl, at carbon number 2, we have a methyl group. So it's a methyl propyl.
And that 2 just denotes it's coming off the second carbon of that second chain.
Right. That's why you put the whole thing in parentheses.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So if you have a side chain that has a substituent on it, just name it like it was its own. Basically compound, and then you attach them parentheses to the
That's
whole
it.
Thing.
Except it's always attached through carbon 1, by definition. So this is the thing we looked at. We could also call this 6-isobutyl, 2,3-dimethyldecane, or 2,3-dimethyl, 6,2-methylpropyl decane. Well, the top one is an IUPAC name. This is the proper name. If you wanted to look this compound up, this is what you would have to enter. But this name is also perfectly acceptable.
Why is it 6-isobutyl?
Well, because in carbon number 6...
Why wouldn't it be 2,3-dimethyl? Oh, yeah, because that's still part of the chain. Okay.
And finally, halogens. Halogens are just named as simple substituents dangling off somebody else's chain. Here we have an octane. We have 2 methyls. We have a propyl and a chlorine. 2,2-dimethyl, 4-propyl, 6-chloro. Alphabetize these. Chloro comes first, then methyl, then propyl, and it's an octane. Now, nomenclature can be a bit of a bother. Yes, it can. I can't take you there, but write this down. If you go to chemistryonline.com, okay, that's my other website, chemistryonline.com. That will take you to the introductory chemistry partition. At the bottom of your menu on one side, there's a button called tutorials. Click on that. If you go all the way down the list, down at the very bottom, there's a prototype organic nomenclature tutorial. This is kind of neat, actually. I did write it myself. You have a drawing palette where you can take and actually, from your computer, draw the structure. It will check the name, make sure it's right, or it'll show you a structure. You type in the name, and it'll check it. It's really kind of cute. Try that. Nice practice.
Is that from the website that you gave us?
No, that's not on that website. You have to go to chemistryonline.com. That's the intro page. The organic page, organic partition, isn't done yet.
Oh, okay.
So, all right, let's look at these and give them names. Look at our first one and say, oh my goodness, it's a neumen, isn't it? We have to untangle this neumen a little bit. We could do it like this. Our front carbon has two hydrogens and a methyl. Our back carbon has an ethyl group dangling down, hydrogen and a carbon. Now you look at it and find the longest chain and figure out which one you want to be carbon one. Our longest chain is going to go up, down, and over. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's a pentane, isn't it? It's a pentane, and in carbon number 1, 2, 3, we have a methyl. Now, isn't that simple?
That one was.
Do this one. Our longest chain here is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons. So it's a butane. We're going to start numbering down here somewhere, so we can have methyl groups in carbon number 2. 2,2-dimethylbutane. Now let's take and change this structure just a little one, a little bit. I put in 2 chlorines. Which carbon do we want to be carbon number 1?
The chloro.
The one that's holding the chlorine, because we're going to name this at 1 chloro, aren't we? Lowest sequence. That's our main chain, and this is carbon 1. Go ahead and write the name. Very simply, we have a 1-chloro, 1,2,3, we have a 1,3-dichloro, 1,2,3,4, it's a butane, 2 methyl groups in carbon 2. 1,3-dichloro, 2,2-dimethyl, butane. All right. We will do lots of other examples of nomenclature. If you look at the little handout, you'll see that we have 10 or 12 problems that we're going to do at the end of class. whatever. Next, I'd like to readdress what we said here about conformational isomers. Now, I said that these things undergo rotation very, very quickly. And because they undergo rotation very, very quickly, we can identify these as the same compound. What I want to point out, however, is that energetically, they are different. They are different. And if we cooled them down to absolute zero, these would be totally different chemical compounds. Let's look at ethane. We have two carbons. It's a little movie. And we're rotating around the carbon-carbon single bond. Again, this thing rotates about 10 to the 6th times per second. So it's really spinning. But you'll note that you can identify two different main conformations here. One where everything lines up. We'll call this one eclipsed. As this comes around, you see how these all line up. All the hydrogens are in each other's face. The other one is over here in the middle, where we have a hydrogen in the middle of this space. That is staggered. These two have slightly different energy. Putting the hydrogens together in an eclipsed conformation is bad. It costs you more energy. We can show that as this thing rotates. This is an arbitrary energy scale. These guys differ by about 12 kilojoules per mole. And the reason for that, simply, is as these hydrogens get close together, the electrons interfere with each other. Again, they're in each other's space. Now, for something like ethane, this is a relatively minor thing. But let's look at butane. This is a sawhorse version of butane. What I'm going to do is convert this to a Newman-like projection, where I'm going to put this carbon in front, this one in back. So it looks like this. Now what we're looking at here isn't just the hydrogens, but we're going to look at our methyl groups. Methyl groups are big. As these guys rotate, when the methyl groups come by, you'll note that they not only get close, but here, they're actually in each other's area. The electrons from one are directly in the space of the electrons from the other. And that's a really high energy, isn't it? So let's look at this as it goes around in our entire sequence. We start off with this one, where the two methyl groups are on opposite sides. And what I'm going to do now is just rotate around this single bond in the middle. After 60 degrees, I get this thing. Now these are all eclipsed, aren't they? But at least the methyl groups are so far apart. If I go 60 more, we have staggered everything. That's good. But the methyl groups are now getting closer. That's bad. If I rotate 60 more, I get the worst. Here are two methyl groups are in the same space. Another 60, same thing as this one. And finally, same thing as this one, after 300 degrees. So if we take and rotate that single bond, this is what we're looking at energetically. We're going to start here with these two anti from each other. That means opposite side. As they go to our first conformation, our first 60 degrees, we call that eclipsed, because they're eclipsed. And this is gauche. Going down, we hit our gauche here that is not eclipsed. That's lower energy. Rotate down another 60, we get the fully eclipsed, which is really bad. Another 60, we're back down to a gauche. Gonna go up to another eclipsed gauche. That's higher, but not as high as this. And finally, back down to where we started. So there's a lot of energy that shows up here as these things undergo rotation. Now, this does not mean that we can actually isolate out these structures at room temperature. You could if you were very, very, very cold. If you cool this molecule all the way down to absolute zero, or just about, it would probably freeze out in this conformation. But as you warmed up, there would be enough thermal energy to start spinning the bond, and we would make these. We'll see examples in cycloalkanes, next chapter, where this becomes very, very important. Because the conformation of a cycloalkane is going to depend a whole lot on these type of eclipsed gauche anti interactions. Any questions on the concept? All right. We did nomenclature going forward. Let's do nomenclature going backward. Here I'm going to give you names and simply draw me a compound. You ask what exam questions look like. This next set that we're looking at are actually questions off of an old exam.
Are those two the same name for the first one?
Yeah. This is just with isopropyl. This is methyl apple. Same compound. For our first compound, you look and you see it's a decane, so we have 10 carbons in a row. You draw a 10 carbon zigzag. You look and you see in carbon number 6, we're going to have an ethyl group. So that's two carbons chains sticking up from your zigzag. In carbon number 4, we're going to have an isopropyl group, which remember, is a methyl ethyl. So in carbon number 4, we have a side chain with two carbons. That's the ethyl. In carbon number 1 of that side chain, we have a methyl group. And that would work. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. In carbon number, is our chain. This is carbon number 1 out here. In carbon number 4, we have a 2-carbon side chain, that's an ethyl. And in the first carbon of that, we have a methyl. Or you could call this a simple isopropyl. Again, up here is carbon 6, 2 carbon side chain, that's the ethyl.
But isn't that only 3? 1, 2, isn't that 4?
No, we're numbering from here.
No, I mean for the ethyl.
2 carbons, 1, 2.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
All right, do this guy, 2-fluoro-3-methyl-pentane. You look and you see it's a pentane. You need a 5 carbon chain. On this 5 carbon chain, at carbon number 2, we're going to have a fluorine. And at carbon number 3, we're going to have a methyl. And that would work. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Carbon number 1, 2-fluoro-3-methyl.
Does it matter if we draw them like how you draw them?
Nope, not at all. In fact, this is one of the great agonies of grading an organic exam, as you might imagine. Everybody is going to draw them differently, aren't you? And so I have to sit and look at each of them and say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, whatever. We have a heptane. Hep, remember, is 7. 7 carbons in a row. At 3 and 5, we have chlorines. And at carbon number 4, we have a dibromoethyl. All right, so this part is really simple. 7 carbons, 2 chlorines, right? Our side chain here is going to be an ethyl. So at carbon number 4, you draw a 2 carbon branch. Okay? Now, on this 2 carbon branch, at carbon number 2, we have 2 bromines. So you draw your 7, put in your 2 chlorines. Carbon 4, put in a 2 carbon branch. Second carbon, you put 2 bromines. There's our longest chain. Chlorines at 3 and 5. Carbon 4, have a 2 carbon side chain, 1, 2. And a carbon 2 of that, we have 2 bromines. Another test question. Draw a Newman projection of the anti and gauche conformation of 1,2-dichloroethane. Ethane, 2 carbons. Start off with a dot and a ball in the back. Carbon number 1, we need a chlorine on it. Carbon number 2, we need another chlorine. We want them anti, that means opposite sides, and gauche, which is somewhere in the middle. That's our anti, first carbon, second carbon, 2 chlorines, and here's a gauche. They're not eclipsed, they're just somewhere in between. Now, which of these guys is going to be most stable?
Anti.
That's right. We want them as far apart as we can possibly get. You thought a methyl group was big. Chlorine, bromine, iodine, they're huge. They're like basketballs. You've got to get them as far apart as you possibly can.
Doesn't electronegativity also have to deal with nomenclature?
No, not really. Not really.
No.
And the last simple exam question. Now, this doesn't mean it was a 5-question exam. I just gave a simple ball and stick. And the test here was, can you interpret the ball and stick, come up with a parent chain, and then come up with a name?
That's four.
2,3-dimethylbutane.
Our longest chain looks like this, doesn't it? 1,2,3,4. It's a butane. That's right. We have methyl groups on carbon 2 and carbon 3. Doesn't matter which end you number from. It's 2,3-dimethylbutane. All right. Let's take a quick break. And while you're on break, because nothing is free, why don't you work the problem set that I gave you? And when we come back, we will look at the problems from this exercise. We could start off here by taking this pair of electrons, moving it up into this space. If we did that, that would neutralize this positive charge, but this carbon would now have only 3 bonds. That means we would have a positive charge down here. Doing it again. We could take this pair of electrons, move them in, neutralize the positive charge, but this guy now would only have 3 bonds. And these are our 3 resonance bonds.
Why wouldn't there be 5? It would just be the same thing.
Well, we can't move here because that's an sp cubed carbon, right? Remember, resonance is between sp squared and sp, not sp cubed. And you know why this is important to organic chemistry? If we have this molecule, we can predict that this carbon, and this carbon will all have positive character. So if it reacts with something with electrons, this one, and this one, all 3 of those will have positive character, 1/3 positive charge. So something with electrons is going to react with this either here, here, or here. That's why resonance is important. Look at this one. Again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sp squared carbons. We're going to do the same thing we did on the other one. That is, grab an electron pair, move it in, neutralize the charge, and leave a positive charge in another spot. So our first move would grab these guys, Put them in. Now our positive charge is in the middle. Our second move, we would grab these, move them in. And now our positive charge is on the end. In this set of resonance forms, this positive charge, this carbon cation, is on a primary carbon, isn't it? It's only bonded to one other carbon. Same thing with this one. The one in the middle, however, is bonded to two carbons, so it's secondary. We will see in the next chapter or so that secondary carbocations are more stable than primary. So we would predict more positive charge here than on the other carbons. Simple logic. This is the benzyl carbocation. Benzyl carbocation is one of the famous ones. It's very, well, relatively stable. We will meet this in lots of reaction mechanisms along the way. We're going to do this same way as we've done before, by realizing that we could take an electron pair here, move it in, and neutralize the positive charge. And when we do that, we leave a positive charge on the ring. Now we can do this again. Take this electron pair, move it up to neutralize this, and put our positive charge here. And we can do it one more time. Move these electrons in, putting our positive charge here. Our benzyl carbocation has its positive charge spread over four carbons. We have them in the ring, and the benzyl group, the CH2, also included. The more you spread out the charge, the more stable a carbocation is. We don't know what aromatic is yet. You have to think carefully about concept map. You don't use words like aromatic until you've introduced the concept. But this is a benzene ring right now. All right, speaking of aromatic, we've done carbocations. This is a carbanion. On this carbon, we have a hydrogen that we don't show, two carbons, and a pair of electrons. So this guy has a negative charge. Now we can do just like we did with the carbocation. We can move this electron pair into the ring as long as we take one of these electron pairs and put it somewhere else. So, what I'm going to do is simply move this in to make a double bond. And then, in order to accommodate that, I have to take these and move them out to make another carbanion. we can do this again, can't we? If we move these guys in, we have to move these out, and we can put them right here. One more time, if we take these guys and move them in to make a double bond, we have to take these, move them up here. And then finally, we can do it one more time. And if you're keeping track here, we have taken our negative charge and we have placed it on all five carbons, haven't we? That means that every carbon has 1/5 negative charge. This is the cyclopentadienyl anion. It's what it looks like. Big negative cloud of electrons. Five carbons in a ring. This is, using your word, an example of an aromatic system. We'll see that when we have 6 electrons like this, spread out evenly over all the atoms in the ring between adjacent sp squared centers, we have an aromatic system, and that simply means enhanced stability. Finally, let's do one more. This one is important because we're going to do lots of carbonyl addition reactions. This is what's called an oxocarbocation. That's a carbocation with an oxygen attached. Just like the benzyl carbocation was very stable, this is very stable too. The reason simply is that we can take this pair of electrons, move it in, and make a carbon-oxygen double bond. Now, why is that stable? Do you know of any other oxygens with 3 things attached that have positive charges? Think of hydronium ion, H3O+, right? Oxygen accommodates the positive charge very nicely, making this a very stable carbocation species. All right, let's do some simple nomenclature. Simple branch alkanes. And these are simple. Step 1, identify your longest chain. Step 2, identify carbon number 1. Name your longest chain. Name your side chains. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. It's an octane, isn't it? We're going to start numbering down here so that our first substituent is on carbon 3. In carbon 3, we have a methyl. In carbon 5, we have a 3-carbon chain. That's a propyl. Methyl comes first. 3-methyl, 6-propyl, octane.
One, two, three, four.
Right, that's exactly right. Moving quickly to the next one. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's a heptane, isn't it? We want to start numbering down here. This is going to give us methyl groups in 3, 3, and 5. If we started at the other end, it would be 5, 5, 3, wouldn't it? Three, five, five, trimethyl heptane. This one is so simple, it's not even worth doing. 4 carbons in a row, it's a butte. It's an alkane, so it's a butane. Carbon 1 is going to be down here. We have 2 methyl groups in carbon 2. As fast as you can light it, this would be 2,2-dimethylbutane. Again, a very simple one. We have a 3-carbon chain. Our methyl groups are on the middle carbon, so we can put number 1 either way, anywhere we want. This is a propane with methyl groups in carbon 2. Our next one, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons in a row. We have ethyl groups here on carbon number 3. This is going to be a diethyl, a 3,3-diethyl pentane. When you get one right, isn't this great positive reinforcement? You do. You just feel so proud of yourself. Once again, in a 5-carbon chain, right? Can make either one carbon number 1. Now we're going to put our substituents in alphabetically. Ethyl comes first, then methyl, and they're both at carbon 3. Remember, all one word. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. 8 carbons. We want carbon 1 to be down here, so it'll be closest to this first methyl group. And we need to say we have methyl groups in carbon 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 is a hex. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, that's 5 methyls, I'm sorry. That's a pent. Pentamethyl octane. All right, draw structures. We have 2,2,3 trimethyl butane. Step 1, you draw a butane parent chain.
Yeah, that would be the same.
On our butane, we'll just let this be carbon 1. We have methyl groups at 2, 2, and 3. And that would work. Do our next one. It's a hexane, six carbons in a row.
Would that be an isobutyl?
No, because these are all just methyl cyanes. Six carbons in a row. At carbon 3, we're going to have an ethyl group. At carbon 2, we're going to have two methyl groups. Ethyl at carbon 3, two methyls at carbon 2. We have an octane, so we need to draw eight carbons in a row. At carbons 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, we have methyl groups. So carbon 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and there's our methyl groups. It's a little fuzzy, but there's a chlorine here, isn't there? Because there's a chlorine there, we're going to want this to be carbon number 1. So our chlorine will be in carbon 2. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, so it's an octane. We have a chlorine in carbon 2, we have a methyl group in carbon whatever this is out here. 2 chloro, 5 methyl, octane. In our Newman here, this carbon has a chlorine attached, doesn't it? That means we're going to let this guy be carbon number 1. Whoops. It's supposed to be up there, I think.
Yeah,
this is wrong. Yeah, forget this one.
Could you write it as 1 chloro 3 methyl pentane?
Well, let's see. Let's go ahead and do the
ethyl. Yeah, ethyl. Yeah.
Our longest chain here is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. It's going to be a butane, isn't it? It's going to be a 1 chloro. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 2 ethyl. Sorry about that.
She said 1 chloro, 2 ethyl.
Yeah, let's try again with this one. I hope I got this one right. Our chlorine here is going to be bonded to one end of the chain. So this, hopefully, is going to be carbon number 1. My gosh, I got it. It's going to be a 1, 2, 3, so 1,3-dichloro. Our longest chain is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, so it's a butane. And on our butane, we have methyl groups in carbon number 2. Well, obviously it's going to be carbon 1. We have a main chain of 1, 2, 3. Methyl in carbon 2, bromine in carbon 2.
Is it, are we learning the RMS configuration for the ship?
Nope. Nope, not yet. Chapter 5.
But that would be like an RMS.
No, because this is an achiral center. It has like four different things attached. This is going to be our carbon number one. We have a 1-chloro, 1,2,3 ethyl, and our long chain is 1,2,3,4,5,6. 1-chloro, 3-ethyl hexane. We have a bromine stuck on the end here, chlorine in the middle, a couple ethyl groups in the middle. We're going to want to make this carbon number one. So we have a 1-bromo is our lowest number. Alphabetically, our second one is going to be, that's carbon 1,2,3,4,5,6. Going to be a 6-chloro. And we have ethyl groups in carbon 3 and 4. This
should be diethyl.
1-bromo, yeah, should be diethyl, whatever. Gee, some of these names are all messed up. Sorry.
So it's just diethyl.
Yeah. But we all understand that, right? All right, let's try this one. Our longest chain is going to be like 1,2,3,4,5,6,7,8,9. Going to be a nonane. We're going to start numbering down here.
Don't you want to start at the halide, though?
No, because this will give us a 2-methyl. We can't make this carbon 1. But our longest chain is 9. So we're going to have a 2-methyl, 1,2,3,4,5,6, 6-ethyl, 6-bromo.
I thought you would be 1,2, so it would be a 4-bromo, 4-ethyl, 6.
Nope, because our lowest number here for first point of difference would be 2.
So the lowest number in the dance alphabetical?
Yep.
Okay.
Always do the lowest number sequence.
Don't you want to start at the halides?
Nope.
So you always start at the lowest.
Right. When we do double bonds and stuff like that, we want to give the double bond the lowest number. But for a simple alkane or haloalkane, you do the longest chain. 2-bromo. Oh, Jesus. This is totally wrong. Somehow I pasted in the wrong sets of structures here. I apologize. But anyway, we all understand the answer.
So
let's quickly do this one.
What's the answer?
Well, the correct answer. We have 1,2,3,4,5,6,7,8,9. So it's a nonane, right?
6-bromo.
It's a nonane with methyl group in carbon 2, an ethyl group in carbon 3, 4, 5, 6. So it's a 6-bromo, 6-ethyl, 2-methyl, nonane.
Wait, didn't you say it would be 2-methyl, 6-bromo, 6-ethyl,
nonane? Yeah, I thought you said
nonane. Yeah,
there is a 2-methyl. But alphabetically, bromine comes first.
Well, that's what I was asking you. You said no. I mean, 4, 4, 8. That was confusing. I was like,
yeah,
oh,
well,
you number it the lower sequence. But then when you string the name together, it's alphabetical.
Okay, so that's what I was asking. So when you string the name together.
Okay. I'm sorry, I misunderstood.
First, always.
Lower sequence and then alphabetical.
Okay.
And finally, this guy has a square attached, doesn't it? The square is going to be a side chain. Now it has 4 carbons in it. So it's a butane, isn't it? It's a ring, so we'll call it a cyclobutane. But because it's a substituent, we'll call it cyclobutyl. Now, this cyclobutyl is going to be attached to carbon number one. And we also have a methyl group. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Our pentane is parent. 1 cyclobutyl, 4 methyl. Here's hoping. 1 cyclobutyl, 4 methyl. My gosh, I got it. All right, one of the exercises that you will see, especially on Blackboard, is very simple. You are given structures and you are asked to identify functional groups. Yeah.
I'm sorry, can we go back to the 6-bromo-2-methyl-6-ethylene? Is that what it was called? I just want to make sure that's what it was called. Was it 6-bromo-6-ethylene?
Oh, this guy. All right. First of all, it's a nonane.
Right.
So you start with that. This will be carbon one. So in our name, we need 2-methyl in there. Right?
6-bromo-2-methyl-6-ethylene.
No, ethyl comes before methyl. So it would be 6-bromo-6-ethyl-2-methyl-nonane.
Okay.
All right, so in our first structure here, what you have to do is simply look and identify the functional groups. Now, we're not going to do the alkane chain. We're only interested in the other functional groups. Here we have a carbon-carbon triple bond, and here we have an NH2. The two are dominant functional groups here. This is an amine, and this is an alkyne. Oh my gosh, and it's raining. Now this one here is going to be a cyclopropyl, isn't it? Cyclopropane. 3-carbon. We're not going to worry about naming the cycloalkanes one. We simply look at the other things attached. We have an OH group, and we have a COOH. Remember, the first oxygen here is a doubly bonded oxygen, a carbonyl, with an OH on one side. This is an alcohol and a carboxylic acid. Our 6-membered ring here, that's a benzene ring. Remember, the functional group for that is arene. Here we have an oxygen that's bonded to 2 carbons. And remember, that is an ether. Now we have a carbon-carbon double bond here. That's an alkene. Not going to worry about that. What is this guy? Carbonyl with a nitrogen on one side. That's an amide, isn't it? It's the heart and soul of biochemistry. We also have a sulfur here that's attached to 2 carbons. That's a sulfide. When you work with sulfur compounds in the lab, as careful as you try to be, they will be absorbed in your skin, into your lungs, and you will smell horrid for a very, very long time. You have to be extremely careful. We're not going to do anything like that in land here for obvious reasons. But it really can be ugly. Here we have a six-membered ring. This guy, carbonyl with an OH. That's a carboxylic acid. Carbonyl with an OH on one side is a carboxylic acid, also written as COOH.
So a carbonyl attached to an alcohol, so it's a carboxylic, I mean, yeah.
To an OH is a carboxylic acid. This is another interesting bicyclic compound. Here we have a carbonyl with an OR. R is some other carbon. Remember, this is called an ester. Carboxylate ester. It's a derivative of carboxylic acid. Instead of OH, we have OR.
How do you, like, remember these? What's a good way to remember these?
You know, there really isn't. I hate having to say this, but there are things in life you just have to remember. And this is one of them. Functional groups, after you do them a while, they start to make sense. But you just have to kind of remember some things. Yeah?
What was the definition of a carboxylic ester?
An ester. If you start off with a carboxylic acid, so this is OH, and you change the hydrogen to a carbon, that's an ester. All right, this one's fun. This is straight off an exam. Draw the structure of an aldehyde with the molecular formula C3H6O. Now you scratch your head and say, what the heck is an aldehyde? Well, it's going to have a carbonyl, isn't it? One side's going to be a carbon, and the other side is a hydrogen. So you simply need to draw a structure that has a total of three carbons. One, two, three. That would work. C3H6O. Give me two isomeric ketones, C4H6O. Once again, what's a ketone? Carbonyl with a carbon on both sides. So here's our carbonyl. I just put a methyl group on one side because I need a carbon somewhere. I've got four carbons to deal with. I could draw this thing this way. We have four carbons, so that's one, two, three, four. Only have six hydrogens. That's one, two, three, four, five, six. So that would work. Anyone see the other one? Instead of a double bond, we could have a ring, couldn't we? That one would work. We could also have a cyclobutane, so have a square, if you will, with a carbonyl attached to one. That would also be C4H6O. So there are three possible. actually, we did these. So let's go ahead and skip through this. This is the same set we did in class. The only one that's different is this guy. Are these identical or isomeric? Six-membered ring, right? Each ring has a carbonyl. Just for jollies, let's start numbering here at the carbonyl. So this is 1, 2, 3 methyl group in carbon 3. If we said this was carbon 1, 2, 3 methyl group in carbon 3, these would be identical. And now finally, last week, remember I messed up two structures, I didn't put in double bonds. I've just been feeling so guilty about that. We were converting these guys into line drawings. Now we all know how to do that now, but I wanted to revisit this so I can make another Converting this to a line drawing. We're going to need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons in a row. Double bond here between the first two, between 3 and 4, and a methyl or bromine sticking up here, methyl up here. And it would look like that. Double bond, the bromine sticking up, another double bond, methyl group sticking up, here's our main chain. Now our other one was an exercise in drawing a perfect octagon. And we need to put alternating double bonds all around. So you draw your perfect structure, put in your double bonds, and it looks like this. Now the reason I wanted to bring this up again is I wanted you to look at this structure and compare it to one that we've talked about. Remember our friend benzene. Benzene was a 6-membered ring with alternating double bonds going around. This is an 8-membered ring with alternating double bonds. Now we said that the unique thing about benzene was that it was so stable. Well, I can tell you cyclooctatetraene is not stable. Now, why is benzene stable? Remember, each of these carbons has a p orbital sticking up. These bond angles are exactly 120 degrees. These are sp squared carbons. They are required to have 120 degrees. So this is kind of like a perfect structure. Our p orbital is sticking up. Our bond angles are perfect. We get overlap from all of these, and we form our very stable, again, this is aromatic system. This guy, our bond angles on a regular octagon are not 120, but as I'm sure you remember, they're 135. You knew that, right? So that's too big. That means that these cannot form a perfect ring like this, where the angles would have to be 120. This is what it really looks like. This is a basket. Our double bonds are up. Reason for that is so that these can be 120 degree bonds. If we flattened it out, like we draw it, these would have to open up to 135. This guy is very, very stable because all of these p orbitals line up perfectly. This is resonant stabilized. This one is not. In order to be resonant stabilized, the p orbitals on your sp squared carbons must line up perfectly. These guys, we'd have orbitals sticking out this way, they would not line up, it doesn't work. This is very stable, and this is not. Any questions? All right, remember tomorrow, we're doing experiment 1.2 on page 30.